So hi guys, we are here with Rick from Def Leppard. Brand new record, Diamond Star Halos. Mm-hmm. Incredible. 7 years in the making. Well, a couple of years in the making probably for you guys, but 7 years since we got something new.
Well, actually, we've been sitting on it for a year. It's it's sort of like trying to keep it under cover has been a bit of a job. But the one thing about the pandemic, it gave us the opportunity to do something. God knows when we would have had the time to do it. Because the touring schedule was such that it wasn't leaving as much of a break to actually go into the studio and record. But it's worked out okay.
Yeah, and it's a fantastic record, 15 tracks. Mm-hmm. I mean, the difficulty is going to be what's the singles from this?
It's a nice problem to have. We're used to it. It's the nature of how we make albums, really. I mean, we try and give the same treatment to every single song, whether it's track one or track 15, you know, and everything in between. We're going to go with a song called Kick, which is pretty commercial. It's our sort of homage to the glam rock era.
Yeah.
It's very influenced by Mark Bolan. And it's just one of those not overly serious, great groove. You just want to clap your hands to it.
It does feel like it's the perfect choice because it's like, in a lot of ways, it's the classic Def Leppard, but with those little twists that you
say. That's right.
And obviously people recognise from the album title that the...
The Diamond Star Halos, exactly. Yeah. But it encompasses where we're at the minute. Mm-hmm. You know, there is a feeling, there's a thread that runs through the album, I think, that does harp back to those days when we were early teenagers, just getting into music. Colour TV was just coming on the... I know I'm sounding like a granddad here, but, you know, we grew up watching black and white TV.
Sure.
All of a sudden it turned to colour. Top of the Pops became a whole new ball game. You know, the glam rock thing was taking off. And that is when, as 12, 13, 14-year-old kids, you're the sponge for this type of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
You never, ever lose that initial thing that you learned at that point in time. Mm. And I do believe there is a thread running through the album that harps back to that 71 to 74 sort of era. Not necessarily like rock bands or anything like that. Across the board, you know, I can hear elements of like Elton John, I can hear elements of Pink Floyd, I can hear elements of the Eagles, Fleetwood Mac. It's not just guitar-based rock, although obviously there's a lot of that around as well. But the general feel, I believe, is definitely that sort of era.
Well, I'm still getting used to the trick because I only just got to hear the record for the first time yesterday.
It's a lot to take in.
I'm still getting used to the track names, but there's a track towards the end that even had a little bit of a Beatles vibe, you know? But it was like... So there's all sorts of different elements that you guys are bringing in. I think that's what's incredible is that... For the fans hearing it, the more and more listens you're going to get, you're going to, you know, you could just sit back and enjoy it and take it for what it is. But if you want to sort of dissect it, you'll hear all those lovely influences throughout the years.
I mean, I appreciate that these days, you know, people less and less are going to sit down and listen to a whole album all the way through, especially one that's the equivalent. Well, it is a double album, essentially. So it's a lot to take in. But with that comes, there is a depth to it. You know, there are some songs that'll be quick burners. They'll get in your head very quickly. And other songs have got a lot more depth to them. So there's a lot to go at for sure. But
you know,
that's kind of what we've always tried to do anyway. We've always tried to give value for money.
Well, you guys, you don't bother doing it unless you've got something to say.
Absolutely.
And at this stage in the career, there'd be no point in
Absolutely
that.
Right.
You get a couple of guests on the record as well, which is nice to see. Alison Krauss appearing on a couple of tracks. How did that come together?
We've known Alison for absolutely years. I mean, she always was a bit of a closet Leppard fan, in fairness. And of course, anybody that's heard Alison sing is like she comes from another planet.
Yeah.
You know, so we have such admiration for her, always have done. And there's a couple of songs on the record that do lend themselves to like a more of a country bluegrass type thing. And It just came up in conversation, you know. Maybe Alison, we ask Alison if she'd like to sing on these, and like, we'll just ask her anyway, you know, and you know, just give her the song and see what she does with him. That's basically all it was. It was like, you know, she was under no direction from us. Here, take the song and just do whatever you know, as much or as little as you want to do. And she was delighted. And you know, Alison's fantastic. We love the work that she's done for years and years and years. Obviously, the connection with Robert Plant as well. She, you know, it keeps her. You know, she's a wide-ranging artist anyway in her own right. She could sing anything.
Yes.
So, you know, it was a no-brainer to try and get her on the album.
It's a great fit, and, you know, that's, you know, asking about the singles, you know, you kind of feel like if one of those came out as well later on, you know, that's a whole different avenue for you guys.
It could be, actually. Actually, yeah.
Obviously, you're massive everywhere, but that's a different audience, isn't it, that's into that, you know, that genre.
Yeah, I mean... We're all for widening an audience, but we're more into widening our scope of what we do.
Yeah,
of course. If the spin-off is that, you know, we attract a country audience along with our normal audience, if you like, then all well and good. That's great. It's at our stage of life. We've done what we needed to do with regards to where we wanted to be when we were starting out. Mm-hmm. We did that many, many years ago. And now it's about maintaining that and also satisfying yourself artistically as well, which is, it was the greatest opportunity to do that because in a strange way, because we never saw each other while we recorded this album, not in the flesh anyway. Sure. We were just in our own little studios at home. And when I say studio, it's literally an interface that plugs into a laptop. I mean, that's a studio these days. It gave us the opportunity to just do a bit more experimentation because you could. I went deep into different ideas knowing that I wasn't annoying anybody else in the band because if it wasn't very good, they'd never hear it anyway. So, and I got the time to do it. Mm. And that actually turned out to be the case with all the other guys in the band. So you do get a little bit more of an adventurous feel to some of the songs because we were allowed the time to do it that way.
I think it's incredible to be hearing that from Phil and Viv earlier that I was speaking with, you know, that is the energy with this, where it's like everyone is just kind of like relieved to have that little bit more time and freedom to try out some different things. And, I was saying earlier as well, you know, like I think for the guys watching, so many of the guys that are guitar players, musicians, you know, that's what their setup is like, you know, just interface into a laptop. Mm-hmm. So to see guys at your level, you're still having a go with that as well, you know, it's very relatable.
Absolutely.
It shows you what can be achieved.
Absolutely right. You can record a great album in your bedroom now. You really, really can.
Yeah.
You know, you got to have the songs and you've got to have the dedication, obviously.
Yeah.
And just the vision and the drive, all those things you can't get in a box, but everything else. Yeah, it's absolutely easier now to actually do that.
Well, one of the extra things you've got, Rick, is those fingers, and you know, we always expect some great low end action on a Def Leppard record or live show, and you know, once again, of course, you deliver on that. You want to talk us through what you mentioned the interface and the laptop, but what was getting plugged into that?
Strangely enough, I'm a huge Jackson fan. I love playing their five strings. There were some songs where I actually revisited an old guitar that I'd forgotten about.
Right.
It's an old Fender Jazz bass. I've had it probably 30 years. And I used it primarily to rehearse some of the tracks on. One song in particular is a track off the album called Open Your Eyes, which is a very bass riff-driven song. And I swear, the reason for doing it on this little four-string Fender was I didn't want to wear the strings out on this on the guitar that I was going to use because, hey-ho, one thing about recording on your own, you're also engineering on your own, and you're also being a roadie on your own as well because you've got... So it's like, I am not going to ruin the strings by practicing this thing, so I'll use this guitar instead.
Yeah.
And I plugged it in and it went, oh, my God. This sounds exactly what we need for the part. Mm. So So yeah, a lot of it was a guitar that had just been hanging on a wall for 30 odd years, and it's a little bit broken.
Okay.
The pots are a little clicky, and it's literally on the verge of not working. So you've got to be careful with the angle that you held it at and stuff. But it kind of worked. It really did.
Does that sort of thing? I mean, I think I know the answer, but like, does that sort of thing like inspire you? Because obviously, you know, with a guitar or bass guitar or any instrument, you can get it perfect every day, really, if you want. But with a voice, you know, you've got to be dealing with what you wake up with some days.
Yeah.
Sometimes having an instrument that has got these little challenges, it forces you to just deal with what that presents.
It gives you a little bit more of an insight into what you're actually putting down, because you do become sympathetic to the actual instrument itself.
Mm.
In the sense that sometimes when it's consistently the same day after day after day, you can take it for granted a little bit. And sometimes you become a little deaf to the actual, the tone that you're hearing, because you're so used to it. And it's great to sometimes just get a little, not a wake-up call, but just hearing something in a slightly different light. And it can affect the way you play it in a good way. It's like all of a sudden it's great to have little reborn moments. Even after 40 odd years, it's like that's cool.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. Well,
it keeps you young, it keeps you fresh, and that translates.
Of course, I mean, what would be the point in doing it if you didn't, you know? And we know that there are some acts out there that it's like that, you know. But with you guys, it's never the case. It's always an incredibly passionate record.
There is a passion to it still.
You can feel it. And even sitting with you here talking about it, you know, like you don't have that. Drive to discuss it and talk about it if it's not genuine, you know. And one of the things, of course, that guys are going to get to see is these live shows where the passion is right there and live. We can't wait to see you guys in the UK eventually. But before you get to the UK again, you get these shows in the US coming up with a fantastic lineup of support.
It's a great, but it's like this was set up for the summer of 2020. It still is, but it was going to be the biggest tour that Def Leppard ever embarked upon. And we were thinking, like, the Christmas of 2019, we're thinking, God, next summer is just going to be amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, after being in a band for over 40 years, to be able to look forward to a tour which is going to be the biggest you've ever done.
Yeah.
It was like, it's almost unreal. It's almost obscene that it should work out like that. But that was it. And then all of a sudden, the rug gets pulled out from under everybody's feet. Mm. And things change, you know. So then it got put back to 2021, which again got put back to 2022. The promoters are really pleased because they've actually added 5 more stadiums, so they're happy. The numbers are going through the roof.
Yeah.
It's by the time we get to the first show, which is in the middle of June in Atlanta, It'll be sold out.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And the good news on that is, and again, I don't want to jump the gun and be too presumptuous, but the original plan was always see what the success of the summer tour in North America is like.
Yeah.
And there's plenty of people that are dying to bring the same thing over to Europe and do that and the following summer.
And the rest of the world as well, surely.
Sure, absolutely, The heat on it is just fantastic. I mean, Motley have been great, in fairness, because they've been given a new lease of life originally with the movie that kind of brought them out of retirement,
Yeah.
I mean, and I think they were waiting for an excuse, but no better excuse than the success of the movie. But So it all seemed to be working great. And then now we've got this Tommy and Pammy thing that's going around. It's boosted the interest again.
Mm.
So, you know, we're under no illusions. It's not just a Def Leppard that's selling tickets. Everybody's, they're all, you know, it's a great bill.
The pressure's going to be on you guys to do another film.
Well, we've got to do a proper one first. I mean, that's, you know.
You did it first.
We kind of did, but I don't think we did it as good, you know.
Well, things have moved on. What I was going to say was, you know, like your love for the, you know, music is... It, just goes from the, well, your very, very early years. But what was the first time that, you know, you can remember really hearing the sound of the bass and it just being your sort of go-to instrument?
I'll be honest with you. A lot of bass players are born to play bass. Mm. They're born bass players. I am not. Mm. If I was born to play an instrument, it would have been the guitar. Mm. I started off being a guitar player. In fact, I'm only the bass player in Def Leppard because we couldn't find a bass player. And literally, when back in 1978, I said, look, this is stupid. I'll play bass until we find a bass player. Thank God we never, 40 odd years later, we still haven't found one, yeah. Thankfully for me. I'd never gravitate towards it. But since then, it's like you learn so much. I just love bass players that don't crowd the situation. Do you know what I mean? In our type of music, I'm specifically talking about. It's got to be about the vocal. It's got to be about the guitars. That's what our music is about. If the bass can actually just make them a sound as good as possible and be a good bridge between them and the rhythm,
yeah,
you've done your job. Yeah, and just do it as you know to the best of your ability. When I was growing up, I loved the bass playing of, like, for example, John Deacon of Queen. How he played around Fred's vocals was just so clever, but so melodic in its own right, you know. Sure. Stuff like that. I've always been a big admirer of Sting, again, because he's the bass player and the singer. There's a sympathy to both, so his bass playing would be sympathetic with the vocal that he's singing.
Yeah.
And that's what it's all about, you know. It's about people latching onto the vocal.
Yeah, talk, you know? The communication, the leaving the space for people to say what
absolutely
they want.
Right. Absolutely right. Absolutely right. Yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. There is room in music for bass players to really, really shine. Mm. It's never been that attractive to me, you know, because I've always been about the song and about the,
of course,
about the other guys, you know, the real musicians in the band.
I think that's what is really sets you guys apart, is that it always seems to be the vibe that comes across in the music, but also when you get to hear you guys talk, because you all get along so well, and I've always got along so well. Yeah. And especially when you think of some records where there's just so much going on, like sonically, you know, it's just a complete wall of sound.
Yeah.
But I think if there was egos involved in that as well, it'd be a mess.
It just couldn't happen. I mean, honestly, you know, we try and do our best in everything that we do, but at the end of the day, we're all a bit of a slave to the unit. Mm. There is no egos. There's just, I don't know, we just enjoy doing what we're doing as a collective so much that's outweighs anything else, you know. And we dearly love each other. We dearly got respect for each other. We don't always agree on everything, but there is such a common bond which is so strong, that's greater than everything else. It would just feel unnatural to do it any other way, you know.
For sure, it makes sense. Just touching on a little bit of Def Leppard history. I mean, for me personally, my first introduction to Def Leppard was hearing Love Bites, and I'd never heard anything like that in my life. Mm. You know, like it just seemed like such a different record to anything else that was around. Mm-hmm. For you guys at the time, been in the studio hearing the whole record coming together, the Hysteria record. I mean, was it blowing your minds how different
you're so wrapped up in the actual recording. You have to remember that when we were recording Hysteria, we were breaking boundaries in the sense that how the recording techniques were taking place and how it all fitted together with electronic and drum machine esque rhythms and things like that. That was very, it's a very hard thing to do, because like anything else, when you're trying to create something a little bit groundbreaking, it's hard work, and sometimes you go down blind alleys to realize that wasn't the right way to make sure that this is the right way. So there was a lot of that going on, but every so often when you spent a week doing one backing track, for example, you just come away and listen to it in a different with different ears and go, we're actually doing something that we've not heard before. Mm. You know, it's going to take a long time, and there was this sense that something special was actually taking place here. Mm. And it wasn't just bands going, oh, that new album's great, you know, best songs we've ever written and all that. There was something more. There was something you couldn't quite put your finger on that was like, I've not really heard any band do what we're doing or we're trying to do, what we're trying to achieve. There's been, you know, artists at the time like Michael Jackson and George Michael that were selling boatloads of records and to a specific audience. We looked at that. Whitney Houston was another one at the time that was selling loads of records to a specific audience. And we looked at it and went, there's no reason why a white English rock band cannot, like, appeal to the masses, if you like. But it's got to be done in a way, and you've got to believe in it, and you've got to be dedicated to create the sound. Mutt Lange takes huge credit for this. I mean, it's not just us, because he was the one driving, you know, sailing the ship, if you like. And a lot of it was a lot of his vision. But yeah, at the time, you just knew, and once you get one song down, it becomes the blueprint for everything else, and it's a standard that you've set, and you work, you know, just work towards that.
It's incredible to hear the behind.
Well, it was the most expensive record ever made at that time, and we were, as kids, we were aware of that, but it meant nothing because we were on a quest, we were on a mission, you know, and at its release, we were told this is a record company thing. You know, you have to sell so many millions before you've even got what it's cost you to make it.
Yeah.
And we were like, so?
Yeah, when you hear what's on the record, you're like, I don't care.
I mean, fortunately, it worked out. Don't get me wrong. It's easy.
It sold a couple. It sold a couple of them.
But that's how it was.
That's for sure. Yeah. Now, with Diamond Star Halos, it sounds like you guys, you know, had a real blast making it, and it was. I'm sure there was some ups and downs or whatever, getting different the right takes and the right sounds and what have you. But what's been the sort of most challenging experience for you in the studio?
The most challenging, I think, it's being your own roadie. Like I said, it's bloody difficult. I'm not very good at changing strings, and there wasn't anybody else around.
Yeah.
You're the roadie, you're the artist, you're the engineer, you're everything. Mm. You know, that was kind of challenging at times. The most challenging individual thing that I've probably had to face since we started was recording the 12 string on a song called This Guitar. It was my idea the song was coming along, and I was just like, I know it's a bit of a cliche, but it's like, I actually said the words, I really think a 12 string would sound great on this. And as I'm saying it, I'm thinking, oh God. And Phil went, great idea then, you know, go ahead and do it. Yeah, like, well, okay. I had a 12 string at home, miking it up. I don't do this. I'm not very good at this type of thing. I mean, it was really, really challenging. Mm. It's hard enough trying to tune a 12-string guitar. It's really bloody difficult for anybody that's tried. Once you've got it in tune, then, you know, playing it to the standard that we demand.
Yeah.
It must have taken me 2 weeks.
Well, it's a whole different animal, isn't it?
It's for me, yeah. Certainly. But again, it's like at the end of the day, this time I walked out the studio, I had to walk around the garden and just clear my head, because it was doing my, I just couldn't play it properly.
Yeah, yeah. I wish you guys had a documentary putting this thing together. Hearing the fact that Phil was recording stuff with his clothes around the speakers.
Yeah, there's all kinds of...
Viv can't get his laptop on.
it would have made a great documentary if it had been possible to actually do that. But these were the things. I mean, recording individually is something we're very used to. There's only two albums we've ever done where we've really recorded it as a band.
Sure.
So the one guy in the chair recording is not that. That's never been an issue. But to actually do it when you the other guys are in different countries. That was like, you know, in a way, very, very liberating. Again, because like I say, it allowed you to be more artistic without upsetting anybody else or getting in their way or on their time because they want to come in and do a solo or whatever. So in that sense, it was great to the point where we've already said the next album, we're going to do it exactly the same way.
Wow. That's
how great he was.
Amazing. I mean, and another thing that's amazing, of course, is that if you check the dates, I would have never have guessed that it's been that sort of time, but 45 years of Def Leppard.
I didn't know. I just swear. I mean, it doesn't take much of a mathematician to work it out.
Yeah.
But
especially after the last couple of years, well, because you lose track of the years.
Well, you absolutely do. Yeah. I mean, when somebody told me, it's like I actually did the math backwards and went, bloody hell, that's right.
Yeah. 45 years of the band. I mean, those early days, you know, just trying to make your way with music and having a great time and ups and downs of it. You know, what did you, if you're putting yourself back into that mindset at the time, what did you want from this band and how does it compare to what the reality has been?
We wanted to be the biggest band in the world from day one. I mean, I suppose everybody might say that, do you know what I mean? But we genuinely did. We were prepared to pretty much take the advice and work with the best people that we possibly could at whatever level we were at in order to achieve that. You know, it was always, I've often thought back and I've looked at ourselves that even then we were songwriters that happened to be in the same band rather than a band that were trying to muddle the way through writing a song, sure, sort of thing. So it kind of came the opposite way around. We didn't realize it at the time, but that's, looking back, that's kind of how we were. So we just wanted to be as good as we really could, but there was something deep down that we knew something was attainable that was beyond our actual perception. Or like I said, maybe every teenager thinks like that. I mean, I can only speak for us. We did. And, you know, I didn't think we'd still be around 45 years. I have to be honest. When you're 18, 30 is ancient and past it and no longer relevant and no longer valid and you're done. You know, we're only just getting started.
Man, I mean, this is the thing, is that, you know, it's still such a style of music that's relatively new when you think about it. You know, but back when you guys were just starting, you know, there wasn't the idea of people playing.
That's absolutely right.
That long, playing till that age.
Well, the old guys when we started are still the old guys that are now. The Stones were in their late 30s and they were ancient, but they were still doing it and still doing it really well, you know. Here we are, and they're still doing the same thing, you know. So they're the ones that keep pushing the boundaries, and relatively speaking, we're still you know, pretty young in comparison.
Oh, yeah, absolutely,
you know?
And many more years to
absolutely
come,
right.
Sure.
That's how we see it. Yeah.
Well, Diamond Star Halos. Do we know when it's going to drop? Because that's the one thing that I don't know yet. When the
single goes to radio on the 17th of March. Mm-hmm. And the album will be released the 27th of May, I'm told.
27th of May. Well, you know, the fans will get to hear that very, very, very soon. Incredible record. Congratulations, Rick, and thanks for talking with us today.
No, my pleasure. Good to be here. Thank you.
Thank you.